Deputy Claire Daly, please. Deputy Claire Daly, without interruption. Thank you. Deputy Claire Daly, please. Thank you.
Thanks, John Corla. Taoiseach, Minister Donoghue made the point this morning that this is a landmark decision, and it certainly is. It marks a new low in the behaviour of this government, in your arrogance, in your undemocratic manoeuvring, and in your contempt for this House, that you would ram through strategic decisions about the future of an almost 80-year-old company that has employed tens of thousands of people and been key in the strategic development of this country in a matter of days. I'm very conscious, Taoiseach, that there are thousands of my colleagues in Aer Lingus, in Dublin, Cork and Shannon, and their families who are looking on at this. I'm conscious of the 15,000 members of the pension scheme who can now draw no other conclusion than that the manoeuvrings around that scheme were part of a deal to get this out of the way so you could get what you wanted all along. And I want to step back and look at where the impetus for this takeover came from. Because this is a profitable company all the years through the economic crisis. It's a company with a confirmed delivery for 9 new long-haul aircraft. It's a company with cash reserves of almost €1 billion. So let's be clear here. The driver of the IAG bid is not what is in the best interests of the Irish nation, the workers or the passengers. The driver of the IAG bid is the commercial interests of the British, European and Middle Eastern shareholders who own IAG. And that will be the driver of their involvement if they get hold of it. And you are proposing to give them ownership of that for €1.3 billion. A company with cash reserves of €1 billion, Heathrow slots worth more than €500 million, the property, the brand, the product. It's an absolute outrage that we will be sitting here discussing this. You talk about positives. Many of those positives were already there. This is a pathetic attempt for you to say that the undoubted negatives are not going to happen. So my questions to you are as follow. How in God's name can you come in here and say that the so-called concessions that you got can stand up to any scrutiny? Your B share, Aer Lingus, you propose would be a captive subsidiary in IAG. What's to stop them using it for themselves or leasing it back to IAG? It's rubbish. You say there are guarantees for workers. The CEO of Aer Lingus, who stands to benefit handsomely from this, says he doesn't foresee any redundancies in the future. Well, I'm sorry, I don't take any comfort from that. And I don't think a group of workers who before were given what Thank they you. Were told were legally binding letters of comfort guaranteeing them, which didn't stand up, are going to take any comfort from it either. So can you explain to us how these guarantees are somehow different? And crucially, could you tell us, what's the big hurry? You were waiting on this for months. Is it that you're afraid that your Labour backbenchers aren't going to be able to withstand the pressure from the workers and the pensioners who are enraged by this?
Taoiseach.
Thanks, Deputy Daly. The position is that when the offer came, first of all, it was not acceptable to government. Quite a deal of discussion with the companies, with the department a move to strengthen what was the original offer. The government have considered this very carefully, and I might say to you that it is about the potential to grow the airline, to grow connectivity, to grow jobs. And that's why the plan that's now set out sees an increase of nearly 2.5 million passengers, 635 new jobs in Aer Lingus. That will create further employment in a wider economy. Clearly, pilots, engineers, airline staff, the tourism industry itself, as part of the strategy now unfolding nationally to grow tourism numbers by a serious amount between here and the next 10 years. Four new routes to North America by 2020. The impact of that will be very significant indeed. The Cork-Paris and the Cork-Amsterdam routes, maintained and promoted, and IAG will pursue those growth opportunities for Aer Lingus services from Cork. The Shannon-New York and Shannon-Boston routes will be maintained, and the IAG plan to grow transatlantic services from Shannon, and talk to any of the passengers who fly to the States from either Dublin or from Shannon. You see the numbers who've come from other locations around Europe because of the importance and the convenience of pre-clearance. This holds very significant potential for the future. And indeed, Knock, in connecting from Gatwick with Aer Lingus, will have the opportunity now to connect into the hub of IAG with 60 other routes. And as part of their drive in terms of the Wild Atlantic Way from a tourism perspective and business perspective, that's a real opportunity. It's also expected that Aer Lingus's cargo capacity will have increased by 50% by 2020. So there have been three hostile bids in the past in respect of Aer Lingus. Nothing to suggest that there wouldn't be others in the future. And the difference now is that the people, the government, on behalf of the people, now have an influence over the connectivity, the sale and the disposal of slots from Heathrow to Ireland, that these will continue with certainty in the time ahead, which wasn't the case yesterday and before yesterday, and that's a fundamentally important element of the growth here. And the transfer of the share to the Minister in the Articles of Association, legally binding guarantee and veto by him on behalf of the people in respect of a slot disposal or slot change, is a very important and much stronger improvement than what was there before. The question of the pension scheme that you mentioned is one that has been very complex for a long number of years. It's not an issue that's part of this particular proposal here. And clearly, I've had contact with people who have been involved in this pension scheme, and of the very many members there, Minister for Tourism, Minister for Transport, has spent a very considerable amount of time over the past 18 months in trying to deal with a very complex situation there. For this, this proposal, government are very happy to support it. It's very happy to note the support from Dublin, from Cork, and from Shannon.
Thank you.
Clearly, the potential to grow the airline, grow connectivity, grow jobs, strengthen our economy, is very important part of consideration here. Protection of jobs, future growth is all part of this opportunity, Cancola.
Deputy Daly, 1 minute, thank you.
You told Deputy Adams that you couldn't answer the questions yesterday. I'm assuming the reason that you haven't done it this time is that you wouldn't be bothered in giving us the respect of answering. You haven't addressed a single issue raised. Many of the positives that you've outlined about this airline are there already. They're already in train. They are an utter irrelevancy to whether IAG take over or not. But what isn't an irrelevancy is the fact of who is going to benefit from that development of business, from that profitability, from that growth. Because we already have an airline that's growing. We already have an airline, interestingly, which takes 1 million passengers from UK regional airports and transits them to the United States through Dublin. Now, wouldn't that be a nice business if you were a Middle Eastern, a European or a British shareholder? You don't have any particular interest in Ireland in that context. Now, Taoiseach, you talk about future jobs. In an airline where 9 aircraft were already booked and confirmed for delivery, new pilots and new cabin crew were inevitable in that. But you've been silent on the reality that the outsourcing and redundancies of ground staff is practically inevitable in this scenario.
Thank you.
Where is the guarantees for these workers? You haven't given any. And, you know, I don't really expect you to, because you know what? You're a neoliberal leader of a neoliberal party. That's what she stands for. That's your record. Fair play to you. But there was a time when people in the Labour Party said they stood for something different. And, you know, the cheek of these people saying they would give commitments to airport pensioners, that if this deal was going to go through, the pensioners' livelihoods would be protected. You'd put the proceeds in a fund to secure their future.
You,
well, where's the money going in to secure their future now?
Thank
it's
you.
An absolute disgrace.
A good old rant there, Deputy Daly. The legislation has been...
The
legislation, as you know,
I think
the legislation, as you know, has been brought forward in respect of the REAs. The commitment here is that all the workers in Aer Lingus will be included in those REAs and they will be extended to those not currently covered. Aer Lingus have not had compulsory redundancies in the past, and the letter is very clear to the Minister for Transport in that regard also. Who will benefit? I hope that our country is going to benefit from increased connectivity, from increased jobs, more pilots. These issues, the issues that you say were not there, or that were there already, you're not correct in that, because you didn't have a guarantee of four new routes from the United States. You didn't have the same impact in terms of the growth pattern for passengers coming through Ireland yesterday. You certainly didn't have the influence and the certainty that will now exist, because the Minister for Finance will hold a veto on behalf of the people in respect of the disposal and the sale of slots in Aer Lingus. And that certainty was not there before, Deputy Daly. And I pointed out to Deputy Adams and Deputy Martin what happened when Aer Lingus decided to move from Shannon to Belfast. This House, this government of the day, was utterly powerless. And that was because of the weakness of the deal that was done by the previous administration in privatising Aer Lingus in the first place. So this is about growing the economy, growing connectivity, creating jobs, new opportunities, growing our hospitality sector, growing our tourism sector, allowing for greater access for multinationals and others to come to the country, and allowing for greater facilities for export and for business to be done from this country. And that's why Shannon, Cork and Dublin have said this is a very good proposal and we back it and support it. It's in the country's interest and in the people's interest.
Thank you. That completes leaders' questions for today.